Well, hey everyone, good morning and welcome to River City United Methodist Church. We're thrilled that you are here to worship with us today, whether that is in person or online. And let me tell you, there's a lot of grace out there if you're in person today, because I got to tell you, this is probably the worst day of the year when we do that whole spring forward thing and we lose an hour of sleep. So if you nod off today, I'm not going to take it personally during my sermon. And I know you won't nod off during the music, because the music's just too good. But if you're not off during the sermon, we'll throw you some grace today. But we're glad that you are here. If you're worshiping online, we're glad you're here with us as well. We encourage you, as you feel ready to come back to worship. We're glad to provide a safe place for people to worship God together. And we want to encourage you to come back. Speaking of coming to worship, we have some real opportunities coming up during Holy Week. That is the week in preparation for Easter, and we want to encourage you to come out on Good Friday. We're going to actually meet over at Dupre Park, which is right down the road here. We're going to meet at the pavilion at 6:30 p.m., and we're going to have a walk that we do where we do the Stations of the Cross through the park. There's a path there, and we're going to have some singing and some reflection and some time of prayer as we walk that path together. If it's raining, we will punt and we will come here and we will have a service together focusing on the Stations of the Cross. But we're going to pray for good weather on Good Friday. And also on Easter Sunday, we're going to have two services. One will be at 9 a.m. outside on the lawn, and one will be at 10:45 a.m. here in the sanctuary. They will be the same service, so we encourage you to come out to which one works best for you. We will also have a rain plan for that we are currently working on. So just stay tuned and watch your email and your text messages and your Facebook and all the ways that we tend to bug you. We are also working in our missions on some flood relief. You can see these buckets up here. These are flood buckets. And on at the table on the way out, if you want to grab some information on how you can make a flood bucket, you can, and we're going to have those turned in by March 21st, which is next Sunday. If you'd also like to give, you can do so on our website at rivercitymethodist.com and just select Mission Opportunities Disaster Relief when you give, and that money will go towards making flood buckets. We also are hoping to put together a day on a Saturday where we go down to a part of Eastern Kentucky and do some flood relief. This would be sometime in the next month, and we would just go on down on a Saturday and come back on Saturday night and do some basic work helping people recover from the floods. So if you're interested in that, be sure to just keep paying attention to the different ways that we communicate. If you don't get those messages, be sure to talk to me after the service or shoot me an email, and I'll make sure that you get on our list so that you can have all the information that is going on. All this info is at rivercitymethodist.com, so we encourage you to go there and to check it out. Also, if you don't mind, take a second to check in on Facebook. For every check-in that we get, we have a generous person that's donating a dollar to these flood buckets to provide relief to people in Eastern Kentucky. This is also just a great way to share your faith with your friends. A lot of people want to go to church with people that they know, and they're looking for a church, and they'll see you checking in, and they'll say, hey, I'll go there with them. Also, take the time, if you don't mind, to share our live on Facebook. This is another great way to share your faith with your friends as well. But the big deal is we're glad that you're here. God's glad that you're here. I really believe that God has something amazing for you today. So let's pray together, and we'll begin our worship. Let's pray. Great God, we thank you so much that you have called us into your place today. Lord, we might come tired, we might come excited, we might come just kind of somewhere in between. But Lord, the big deal is that we're here and that you're here. And God, that you promise to come and do something new in our life. Lord, we're in a season of the Christian year where we focus on repentance, where we focus on you. And so God, during this time, may everything else just melt away. May we hear your word, may we sing your songs, and we have conversations that lift us up and lift you up. And God, may we leave this place closer to you than when we came. For God, there is a world that needs to know of your great love. And God, you choose to use us to do that. So God, help us to experience your love in this hour so that we can go share it the rest of the week. For it's It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and worship together.
I hear your voice in the whispering wind that blows, but I don't know which way. Walking in the wilderness, but I know through every changing thing, still you reign. You are calling me. Yeah, you are calling me. So suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky, from the rivers to the mountaintops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. heart its native cry. Oh, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'd sing Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise rise. Christ be strong and worship you. If it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Because death is just a doorway into resurrection life. If I join you, I'll join you when you rise, when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints. My heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we turn our hearts to God in prayer today, I just want to refer back to that song that we just sang about Christ being magnified in us. And, you know, that idea of something being magnified, I think that that is a lot of times what happens in our lives, right? That something gets magnified and we can't focus on anything else but that. Over the past few weeks, we've been looking at the Israelites as they were wandering through the desert. And I think the thing that got magnified in them was desert, sand, thirst, cactuses, being sick of each other and being sick of being in a desert. And the things that got magnified were the fact that God provided manna from heaven and they wanted more manna, and so they stored it up and they needed these things. I want to ask you the question, what's been magnified in your life? Are there certain hurts or habits or hang-ups that you've been struggling with that have been magnified? Because if Christ is going to be magnified in us, you know, some of those things, they got to be dealt with. But it's so easy to just push them aside and to say that we don't need them. But one of the things that I believe is that God really cares about the things that you're facing. And so many times, as I've talked to you, and I've said this too, but like we say what's going on in our lives and our struggles, we say, but man, somewhere somebody else is struggling so much more than me. Has anybody ever said that before? And it's kind of a way, and maybe a little bit of a defense mechanism to say, it's really not that big of a deal what I'm going through. But I believe God is our loving parent, and if your loving child came to you and said, parent, I'm going through this, I think you would really care. Or if your friend came to you and said that. So let's go to God in just a time of prayer. And I want to give you a few moments of silence just to say what's magnified in your life right now. What is it that you're dealing with, that you're struggling with? And then as we pray for that, we'll pray that maybe Christ could be magnified in that thing and through your life. But let's turn our hearts to God in prayer. Lord, so rarely do we get silence. It's so rare to us that we feel uncomfortable. Maybe in our own minds we count down how much longer this silence is going to go. But God, in the moments of silence, Lord, your voice comes and your voice speaks. God, you love every person that's in this room. Lord, you love every person that's watching this video. God, your word says that you formed us in our inmost being, that you knit us together in our mother's womb, that you have called us by name, each and every one of us, and you say that we are yours. And God, when we walk through waters, Lord, you promise that those waters, they're not going to overcome us, Lord, that we're not going to drown. We might get wet, God, but Lord, we're not going to be overtaken. God, that when we walk through the fires, Lord, we might feel the heat, but we're not going to be burned. We're not going to be consumed. For God, you are with us wherever we are and whatever we're facing, Lord. You are there, and you are walking with us, holding our hand, carrying us many times through those waters and through those fires. And God, we thank you for your presence. But God, in each of our lives, Lord, there's things that are magnified. There are exciting things that we're getting ready to experience, Lord, that are just magnified in our life, God. And that's an okay thing. That's a good thing. And God, we pray that we can see you in the midst of the blessings and the joys that we're experiencing. God, we can see how your handiwork is being made, Lord, and how you are working through those things. But God, there's also struggles. There's also hurts and worries that we have that are just magnified today. And so many times, Lord, we can't see around them for we don't know what you're doing. We don't understand where you're going. But the good news is, Lord, is that, God, when we don't know what to pray, when we don't know what to say, when we don't even know what to do, Lord, that you're already interceding for us. Lord, that you're already working for the good in every situation that we face. God, help us to believe that. And God, as we lay these things that we're thinking about at your feet, Lord, as we lay these people maybe that are sick, really lay these people that are frustrating us or worrying us at your feet. God, help us to know that you are working in these situations. God, we pray for those that feel distant from you, God, that in this time that they might be drawn back to you. Lord, we pray for those that are sick that you would provide comfort and you would provide peace. God, we pray for those that are burnt out and overworked and the candle is burning at both ends and they just don't know what they're going to do next and they don't know how they're going to have the time to care for the people that they love, God. God, would you give them a sense of your peace and help them to know that they don't have to do everything? God, most importantly, let us trust you. God, we've come this morning, and Lord, we've wanted to start our week focused on you. So God, help us to trust that you're going to walk with us this week, this month, this year, and the things that we're facing. God, there might be things that we've given up on that we say there's no hope in this, Lord. Lord, you are our hope, and you are our salvation, and it's in you that we have trust. So God, when the things that are magnified seem so big, may you be magnified in them. God, help us to look deep into our situations to find you and to see you. For we know that you are at work, and we know that you are moving. And God, we trust that you are working for the good in everything that we face. Lord, we don't do these things through our power. We don't depend on our own strength. But instead, we depend on your strength as we join together in the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our gospel reading today is from Matthew 4:18 through 22. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and they immediately left the boat and their father and followed him. Matthew 8:18 through 22. When Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders to cross to the other side of the lake. Then a teacher of the law came to him and said, Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Another disciple said to him, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. But Jesus told him, Follow me and let the dead bury their own dead. The word of God for the people of God.
So, hey, our scripture for today is kind of interesting. You know, Jesus is normally that comforter, right? Jesus is normally there for you. And I actually did a funeral yesterday, and I wonder what would have happened if I would have said to the family, let the dead bury their own dead, come and follow Jesus. It probably wouldn't have been a really good response, would it? It probably would not have been the most pastoral thing to say. But we have two responses to Jesus in these passages that I think really kind of sum up our responses to God. You know, there are times in our life where Jesus says, come and follow me, and we, like the disciples, leave everything immediately. We leave our jobs, we leave our family, and we go and we follow Jesus. And there's other times when we hear the call of God and we say, hey, God, I'm coming, but let me go and let me care for my family. Let me go and let me take care of my job. Let me go and figure this out. And then, hey, after I figure that out, then God, I will follow you. I want you to think of times in your life just for a moment. You know, we probably all have them where, you know, God or you felt led to do something and you immediately responded like the disciples did. It's almost like they jumped out of the boat and they immediately went and they followed Jesus. Maybe there's been a time for you where you saw someone that needed help or you heard a tap on the shoulder or you felt like you were supposed to call someone and you immediately did it and you could say, wow, that was maybe a response from God and God led me to go and to do that good thing. Or maybe you just knew over time that God calls you to do the right thing, that God calls you to love people, and you don't know if it was God or not, but you knew right then and there that the right thing to do was to care for that person. It was an immediate response where you said, yes, I'll come and I'll follow you. Do you have that situation where God has been so clear, where you have responded in such a way? I know I have a few of those where I've said, wow, that was an example of God really showing up. But I also know I have a lot of those times where I've kind of gotten to a negotiation with God, where I say, okay, God, I know that you want me to do this thing, but in all your wisdom, in all your everything that you know, have you thought of this, God? And I kind of see God up there, luckily being a loving God, kind of just shaking his head and smiling and nodding at me and at you and say, yes, Derek, I have thought of that. Yes, Derek, believe it or not, I'm the creator of the world, and Derek, you aren't as smart as me. I have thought about that, and I'm working in that. But still, like, you know, the man that didn't have a place to go, that wanted to go back and to care for his family, so many times I say, God, I don't know if you've really thought of everything. Have you ever been there? Where you said, I know maybe God is leading me in this way, but I've got to go take care of this, and I am so smart that I need to go and take care of it. And a lot of times it's a good thing. There's nothing wrong with going and caring for your family. And in fact, if your family was about to pass away and you took off and you started following somebody and left them, I bet it would look pretty bad upon you. Some of the times the things that distract us are really good things. But there's a few stories with Jesus. There's stories of people that responded and didn't respond. And I want you to think about where you are. Who are you most like today in these stories that I'm going to tell you? There was a man that came to Jesus and he said, Rabbi, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, what do the scriptures say? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. This man looked at Jesus and said, I've done that since I was a youth. Feeling pretty good about himself, saying, I got this thing, I got this eternal life thing figured out. I got it in the bag. But Jesus says, one thing you lack. Go and sell everything that you have and give it to the poor. And then come and follow me. And this man, he took a deep breath. He lowered his head. And the scriptures say that he walked away sad. For he was a man of great wealth. And that was the one thing that he couldn't do. The one thing that he couldn't do was to sell everything that he had, give it to the poor, and come and follow Jesus. And this scripture has been used to pick on people of wealth. And maybe it's a conversation that we need to have. But maybe for you, it's not money. Maybe you're like, yeah, you know, I'll sell things. I'll give to the poor. I'll take care of the needy. I'm generous. I have a generous heart. I want to do that. But I bet there's something that if you came up to Jesus and said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And all of a sudden you got that figured out. And Jesus said, hey, one more thing. Go and, what is it? Go and, what is it for you? You know, for me, when I was in college, it was, I loved to swim. I was a swimmer. And God came to me one day, I believe, and said, hey, I would rather you be at the University of Kentucky than Asbury College. And one of the reasons was I just wanted to go to Waffle House at 11 o'clock. Asbury had a curfew, and I liked Waffle House. And I usually didn't get hungry until about 11:30, and the curfew was at 11, so that we had a problem. And that wasn't the calling that God gave me. That was more the calling that Derek gave me, that he wanted to go to Waffle House. I should have stayed at Asbury. I'd probably look a little bit better today if I would have stayed there. But I had this feeling in my heart that, you know, there was something God could do with me at the University of Kentucky. And I don't know how, I decided this or where exactly it came from, but I felt this deep calling and this deep yearning to go to the University of Kentucky. But believe it or not, even despite the Waffle House, I was a pretty good swimmer. I'd grown up swimming. I had gone to college on a swimming scholarship, and I didn't want to give that up. In my freshman year, I actually got the opportunity to swim in the national meet. It was really funny. The national meet, guess where it was? Canada. That doesn't make any sense, right? How is the national meet in Canada? So we go to Canada, and we switch from swimming yards to meters. I'm still pretty bitter about it. And, I didn't do that great. And I said to myself, you know what, I could be really good by my senior year. But God was still poking me in the heart and saying, hey, I need you at the University of Kentucky. And I said, maybe I'm making too big of a deal out of this. Maybe this is just Derek's desire to go to Waffle House at 11:30 or other places, right? And so I'm walking through the pool one afternoon, and someone I had been competing against, maybe he wanted me to just leave, but he was better than me, so he wasn't that worried about me. He was a Christian, and he said, man, I just got a word for you. I've been thinking. You know, I think that God can use you somewhere, and I don't know what it is, but I think God is leading you to go somewhere, and are you open to that? And this guy barely knew me. All he knew is that he was faster than me, and he was a Christian. And I was like, wow, maybe God's saying something to me here. And then I started reading the scriptures, and I actually did this devotion called My Utmost for His Highest. And if you're looking for a daily devotional, this is a great daily devotional. And the question that came to me from that daily devotional was, are you going to feed your ego, or are you going to feed my sheep? It was looking at the Apostle Peter, and the Apostle Peter was a lot like me. He had a pretty big ego, but Jesus also called him to feed sheep. And so through that experience of, you know, going to nationals and wanting to be the best swimmer that I could be, you know, God also said, hey, I've got something different for you. And so I responded to that call, and I went to the University of Kentucky, and I was able to join a fraternity and start a fraternity and sorority ministry that was spread all over the campus with a group of friends, and it was a real blessing. I saw God do so much through that. It's amazing when you have guys in your fraternity that, you know, are doing some things we won't talk about in church on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night, and then, you know, on Sunday morning or Wednesday afternoon when you do a Bible study to them, you know, they come out of the Bible study and they look at you and go, man, God's just effing awesome, right? What? Did you bleep that out, Thomas? I didn't say the word if anybody was wondering. That was like the weirdest affirmation of faith I've ever heard in my life. You know, that one doesn't make the hymnal. But it was amazing that this guy, what God was doing in his life. And I don't think that's just because Derek said yes and left Asbury and went to the University of Kentucky. But you know, the things that I did know is that I got to be a part of that because I said yes to God and I trusted God. And I got to go to Waffle House as well, too, at 11:30. It was, again, the best and worst thing that's ever happened to me. But I wonder if there's that thing, whether it's selling all your stuff and giving it to the poor, whether it's trusting God with your next job, whether it's trusting God with your next relationship, whether it's trusting God when God says keep going and you want to give up, that God's saying that's your one thing. What's your one thing today that's holding you back in your faith? You know, for the Israelites that were wandering through the desert, it was trust. Moses had been up on the mountain for quite a while, right? And they started freaking out because Moses was up there with God, and they didn't think Moses was coming back. Maybe Moses and God had just kind of become really good friends, and they were going to stay up there on the mountain together forever. So instead of trusting God, they decided to trust a calf, right? A calf, a cow. It wasn't just any cow. It was a cow that, you know, they had made, a golden cow, and they started worshiping it. And then they even, throughout the times in the desert, made other things, like maybe a serpent. And then they made these things that they decided to trust more than God. And you might sit here saying, Derek, I don't have this mad cow disease thing. I am not going to worship a cow. I hate snakes. I'm terrified of them. There's no way that I'm going to worship a snake. But what's your one thing? See, I worshiped the idea that I could be an All-American swimmer maybe one day. God had a different plan. And maybe there's something today that you're holding back from God and you're saying, hey, that's my one thing, God. I think that's why Jesus said, you know, foxes and dens, they got a place to rest their head, but if you come and follow me, you might not. Do you have that level of trust to give God that one thing? Sadly, the rich young ruler, at least at that point, didn't have the trust. Maybe later he did. I don't know. We don't know the rest of the story. Maybe he went home and thought about it and gave all he had to the poor and decided to follow Jesus, but we don't know. But we can know about your story. What are you holding back today? What is it God is saying this Lent, man, this Easter, as you begin to worship the risen Savior? Man, would it be different if you didn't hold this thing back? You know, there's one lady that didn't hold anything back from Jesus. I love the story of this lady, and I wish I had this picture that I could have brought here with you. Someone drew of this lady for me. But this lady had been bleeding for many years, right? She had been bleeding for year after year after year after year. And she had been kept away from the people, kept away from the church, kept away from her family, for she was ritually unclean. But she heard one day that Jesus was going to pass by. And what she believed is that if she just got close enough to Jesus to reach out and to touch his clothes. She didn't even need any of Jesus' time. She didn't want any attention. She didn't want Jesus to pay any attention to her. She just wanted to reach out and touch the cloak. And if she reached out and touched the cloak, man, that she would be healed. Do you see the difference between her and the rich young ruler? Do you see the difference between her and the Israelites that were wanting a calf rather than just a moment to be with Jesus, right? That she would be healed. So Jesus was walking with a rich man, actually, and he was going to heal this rich man's son. This was a man of influence, a man that didn't want to waste any time. Right when Jesus got out of the boat, this man was on the dock saying, let's go, my son's dying. But this woman was on the way. And so Jesus is walking, and at this point, Jesus has created a big name for himself. And so wherever Jesus went, people showed up, right? They knew that he was going to be there. If they had cameras, they would have been using them. If they had their phones, this would have made the videos. But Jesus is walking, and there's this large crowd. They didn't have to stay 6 feet apart. They were all touching each other and bumping into each other and saying, hey, Jesus, and giving high fives. And Jesus is walking with his disciples, and his disciples are trying to hurry him on because this guy that he's going to heal, this kid, this is a big guy. And you know, this person can really support their ministry and can take him to the next level. This one's going to make them be the Messiah and help them to reach where they need to be. And all of a sudden, from the side, this woman sees Jesus. And she says, if I just position myself so that I can reach out and touch his cloak, then maybe, just maybe, I'll be healed. So she gets in just the right place, and people are pushing her to the side, and they're kind of avoiding her because they kind of knew who she was. And Jesus walks by. She reaches out, touches his cloak, and Jesus stops. And to her dismay, her nightmare comes true. Jesus says, who touched me? And Peter and James and John, they're like, are you kidding me, Jesus? We're in a parade. There's tons of people around. They're not staying 6 feet apart. Everyone has touched you. Everybody's touched you. Everybody that's around you has touched you. Jesus, come on, let's move on. Let's go to this rich man's house. Let's heal their kid so that he can be better. But Jesus says, no. I felt power leave from me. Who touched me? And much to this woman's dismay, she raises her hand. Now, remember, this woman for years, every interaction she's had has been negative because she's unclean. Every interaction she's had has been negative. And Jesus, I believe, forgets about all the people that are around. He kneels down right in front of her looks her in the eyes and he just says, wow. Wow. Your faith is amazing. Your trust is amazing. You thought that if you just got within arm's distance of me, that your life would be changed. Your faith has healed you. Now go. Do you see the trust? Do you see the different response that they had? Do you see the fact that she was able to be healed in that moment and her life was forever changed? And I don't think she walked away sad. I think she walked away glad to be able to follow Jesus and to be healed. Very different than the rich young ruler. Very different. Now, those two stories are extreme, right? The rich young ruler walked away sad. This woman, she walked away glad. If you look at the times that these disciples that decided at moment's notice to go and follow Jesus, there were times where they really had to figure it out as well. There were times where they raised their hand and say, Jesus, I don't understand, or Jesus, I don't think that's the right way. Remember that I did that a few times when I said, God, I don't think you really know everything. And in fact, Peter, one of the ones that, you know, jumped out of the boat immediately and decided to follow after Jesus. There came a time where Jesus said, who is it that you say that I am? Some people say that I'm a good guy. Some people say that I'm a prophet. Some people say I'm a good teacher and I can preach a good sermon. But who do you say that I am? And Peter stood up, kind of like that woman, and had amazing trust. And he said, you are the Son of God. You are the Messiah in whom we can trust. And Jesus says, oh man, this is a great day, Peter. You finally got it right. This is not of you. This is of God. And man, you nailed it. And I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And on you, Peter, I'm going to build my church, right? And so Peter's like, sweet, man. He got an A+ today. Good grade, right? Full participation points. Way to go, Peter. So Jesus kind of lets the good vibes die down a little bit. And he says, all right, so they've confessed that I'm a Christ, so I'm going to tell them a little bit more about what's going to happen. And so he tells Peter, he says, hey, there's going to come a time where I'm denied, I'm betrayed, and I'm deserted. I'm going to go to the cross, and I'm going to give my life so that people might be in relationship with me forever. This is where this trip is going. So Peter says, time out, Jesus. It's not really what I signed up for when I said that you're the Messiah, Son of God thing. It's not what I meant. He said, you can't say these type of things in front of these people, in front of these disciples. You see what he was saying? He was saying, God, Jesus, you don't know what we should be doing. And just after he'd gotten an A, he gets an F. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. It's a powerful statement. For you do not have the things of God, but the things of man in mind. You know, I mean, and I love that story about Peter, because neither of those were deciding or final moments for Peter. They might have been big moments in his life. But that last statement, you don't have the things of God, but the things of man in mind. I think that is the thing that we hold back so much. You know, could you live a life where you have the things of God on your mind more than the things of man? Could you live a life where you just say, if I just get in the presence of Christ, then my life can be truly changed? If you begin to have the things of God on your mind more than the things of man, you're not going to walk away sad, because you're going to know that these things of God, these things that you can trust God with, are so, so good. And honestly, when I saw that Andrew was singing the song of Christ being magnified in our lives, whose life was Christ magnified in those stories? Obviously, it was magnified in the life of a woman that had enough trust to reach out and to touch God and believe that you might be healed. Can I ask you today, what is it that you're reaching out to for God and saying, God, I want to trust that this might be healed? Is there something in your life where you're like Peter? You know, I think Peter just didn't understand. You know, and he spoke maybe too quickly when Jesus said those things. Is there something where you need to reach out to Jesus and just say, Jesus, I just don't really understand. Could you help me understand what you're talking about here and how you're leading me? The thing that I don't want for you today, I don't want you to walk away sad. And I don't think you'll walk away sad if you simply reach out to God in those areas where maybe you're doubting, maybe you're struggling, or maybe you're just saying at the end of the rope, saying, God, I need you to work in this situation. It's been 9 years. She'd been bleeding for 9 years. She probably lost all hope. She's on her last rope. She said, God, maybe I should trust and try you. And maybe that's where you are today. If you want God to be magnified in your life, if you want to give up worshiping cows and worshiping snakes and worshiping things that really aren't going to lead you to where you want to go, and let's be honest, we all do it. We might not bow down on our hands and knees before it, but we do bow down in other ways. If you want to allow Christ to be magnified in you, maybe it's putting that trust and saying, God, would you help me understand? Would you help me and would you heal me here? Lord, I don't want to walk away sad. Lord, I want to respond. And if that's you today, I want you to follow the first scripture that we read, where you might respond immediately to God, where you might do something even today. That doesn't mean that you have to go sell everything right now. That doesn't mean that you have to go and to leave your father and mother and your family. In fact, please don't do that. But maybe there's something right now in that thing where God has been pushing you, where you say, okay, God, I'm willing to take that first step. I'm willing to take that first step with you. For those disciples, the first step was to leave their boats and nets and follow Jesus. It was just the beginning of their journey, and maybe today is the beginning of your journey as well. There's going to be a lot of wandering in the wilderness, but we know that God is leading us somewhere. But we have to respond. Let's pray together. So God, I pray that you give us courage today. I pray that you would give us courage to respond to whatever it is that you're calling us to be. God, sometimes it's a life-changing events, a new career, Lord, a step in our family. God, giving something up or picking something up. God, we don't know what it is for one another, but we know that you are calling us to step forward. So, Lord, we want to step forward today. We want to trust that you are going to work in us. And you're going to work this out for our good, but also for your good. So, God, help us to have the faith of the woman that reached out and just get a touch of you. Help us to have the courage to come before you and just say, God, we don't understand. Would you help us understand? God, help us have the courage to leave whatever it is that we're struggling with in your hands, knowing that you're going to work. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we celebrate communion today, we're going to sing a song that Christ truly is our cornerstone. And as we do that, we want to give you a time to just confess your need of God and confess your sin and trust that God will come to forgive you. So as we prepare our hearts for communion, would we take a few moments of silence just to confess our need of God, where we have fallen short, and believing in God's forgiveness and grace. God, create in us a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within us. Restore unto us the joy of your salvation. And give us a sustaining spirit. Lord, we believe the good news that in the name of Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven. Amen. On the night in which Jesus gave his life for us, he took bread. He gave thanks for the bread and broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you eat of it, remember me." And after the supper was over, he took the cup of a new covenant, and he said, "This is my blood, which is spilled for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink of it, remember me." And so, Lord Jesus, now we ask that your Holy Spirit would be poured out upon this bread and upon this cup, that it may be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body and blood of Christ. God, we pray that your Holy Spirit be poured out on each person here. Make us one with you, one with one another, and one in ministry to all the world. For one day we'll feast at your heavenly banquet, Lord, but until that day, we come and we meet you here, just as the disciples did, just as the people in our stories did. God, we come and we meet you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We would encourage you to use this song as a time to celebrate Holy Communion and also just a time to meet with God. Allow God to be your true cornerstone. If you can confess your need of God in any way, then you're invited to celebrate Holy Communion. It's an open table, and God always has a place for you at it. Let's worship together.
Christ alone.
Stepped into my Egypt, you took me by the hand, and you marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Had this swallowed up forever by the fury of your love, you stepped into my took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. 'Cause you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea. You have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. 'Cause you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea. You have led me through the deep. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah.
Well, we hope you've been encouraged by your experience of God today in worship. As you leave this place in just a few moments, if you feel led to give your tithes and offerings, you can do so as you leave. But that song we just sang said that God steps into our Egypt and walks us to our promised land. And the reason I told you those three stories today is God steps into those stories. And I believe he led every one of them into the promised land. I believe and I hope that at some point, that rich young ruler said that, hallelujah, that death has been swallowed up in victory. We know that Peter said, hallelujah. And we know also that the woman that reached out to Jesus said, hallelujah as well. So I believe that God steps into your story today. And God leads you to the promised land. So my prayer for you this week is that you would experience that. And that on Easter Sunday, every Sunday and every day, you have the opportunity to say hallelujah. After you receive this blessing, you may go in peace. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. Be gracious.